Magandang araw, Kapamilya. This weekend is the last weekend before the end of the registration for the 2022 elections. Now, of course, this last week was really a very exciting week for us in the Philippines, where all of the presidential candidates now announcing. Of course, you have the very first one was Ping Lacson, and then you have Manny Pacquiao, and now you have Isko Moreno. Of course, at the same time, there's a lot of, you might say, a lot of dynamism in both Filipinas, for example, pushing people to register. And according to some of the stories that I heard, really the young people are really coming out to register. No? In fact, according to the COMELEC, they've surpassed their targets, original targets, but they're pushing for more. And the one of the last set of data that I saw was 51% of the registered voters would belong to the youth sector. Kaya today, we invited two of our favorite historians, actually, Dr. Leloy Claudio, all the way from Berkeley, California, and then also Mr. Carlo Santiago, whom I've been working with on several projects. No? So welcome, Leloy and Carlo. And so let's get to the main point of the discussion. No? So, why is the youth vote important in these elections? And also maybe to give it a historical context of how the youth movement somehow influenced, you know, our history. So please go ahead. I will listen as usual.
Well, you know, Father, as most people know, our history or our nationalism was born within the crucible of a youth movement. So in 1872, the Spanish government cracked down on liberal nationalist causes in the Philippines. So a lot of that energy had to move abroad because the situation in the Philippines dito, sa Pilipinas, masama, hindi ka pwede mag-organisa. So in 1872, by the way, may repression din 100 years after 1972. So in 1872, nagsimulang pumunta yung mga tao abroad para mag-organize doon. And we know that by the 1880s, you had a group of students led, of course, by the preeminent Filipino nationalists of the period, Jose Rizal, organizing for reforms in the Philippines. And when Rizal, of course, discovered that reforms in the Philippines under Spain would not work, he went back to the Philippines and organized La Liga Filipina, which was really another youth group, in order to begin the creation of a Filipino nation that would stand independent of Spain. So, you know, there's our history is inextricable from the fresh ideas that our youths are introducing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and in fact, remember in my message to you, who was it that said it? Was it Nick Joaquin or O.D. Corpuz? I'm not very sure.
That was O.D. Corpuz, yeah. Father. He said, the concept of the nation was born in the classrooms, because what Lele was talking about, the liberal reforms, what it ushered in was a different kind of teaching. They were teaching humanities. And by doing so, they weren't teaching nationalism per se. They were teaching the values of liberalism, which was liberal thought, human dignity, and by doing so, the students put one together, and they came up with this growing consciousness, this growing national consciousness. And another thing that happened also was, on a more practical note, what the classrooms did was they brought the students in one setting where they could have a common experience. And this is a very, mm-hmm. this was a very important thing. Because prior to that, people, and you know how very regional we are, meaning Ilocano ako, Pampanggeño ako. So what the classrooms did was when those liberal educational reforms came, the well-to-do families sent their children to Manila, and that's where slowly their world began to grow beyond their barrios. They started to talk about how it is when you're in a dorm or in a classroom. Yeah. You have a roommate who's from Bicol. They start telling you stories of how Bicol is, and someone from Negros, and so that's when they started forming a national consciousness, and that was very important.
If I may add, Father, the classroom is a very important place. We tend to think of the classroom as unreal because Many times teachers will come in, they'll say, you know, class, when you get to the real world, so the assumption is that the classroom is unreal.
Yeah.
But actually, the classroom can be very real. In fact, compare. A lot of people, when they graduate, when they leave the classroom, they enter 9-to-5 jobs, and they focus entirely on their jobs, right? Or they become careeristic. I'm not saying all Filipinos do that, but a lot of Filipinos do that. They become extremely careeristic, narrow in their purview. How real is that? You know, in the classroom, if it's a great classroom, it's a place where you can imagine the rest of society. It's a place where you talk about the poor. It's a place where you talk about the future of your country. So I think, you know, that can actually be more real than, you know, a life outside the classroom. And the reason why youth are important is because they bring that reality into the conversation. Marami sa mga gurang dyan, marami sa mga tatanda, nakakalimutan na namin paano mangarap eh. Well, hindi naman kami ganun
katanda ni Carlo. Very important
even
point.
In our mid-30s and early 40s, nagkikik in na, nakakalimutan mo na paano mangarap, pero yung reality ng classroom is yung reality ng pangangarap. At totoo yun.
In fact, just to digress a little bit, and then we'll go back to trace this historical development of the youth movements in the Philippines. No? I don't know if you recall a few years back when the protest movement in Hong Kong, for example, led by the students, young people, there was a special report on, or it was just a news item on CNN, that they attribute the protest movement because years back, Hong Kong introduced a certain parang liberal education track in the high schools of Hong Kong, no? That for so many years, you study the humanities, and then at the end of that period, before you graduate, you write as a paper. And that's where, according to the analysis, that's where all of these, they call it activist ideas came in. You know? So I agree with you. No, that's. Now that my other question, which let's get to towards the end of our conversation, is now that there is no face to face, what do we do? No? So anyway, let's trace it. Okay, from 1872. So okay, go ahead, please. Go ahead.
I think the best example of what Leloy was talking about earlier was between Rizal and his fellow revolutionaries, the one who were a bit more activist oriented, I think sila evangelista yon, no, Leloy. When they were in Ghent, I remember I was reading a letter written by Evangelista to Rizal before. Evangelista was the, correct me if I'm wrong, he was the one who came back from Europe. And he joined up with the Katipuneros, and he was responsible for putting up the palisades, the fortifications of Cavite, and which pretty much stemmed the tide with the first onslaught. Unfortunately, he died defending, I think, Zapote Bridge. Correct me, join in, Lelo, if I'm basically, Evangelista is one of my favorite heroes. His life was cut short, but I remember reading a letter he wrote to Rizal, and he was telling Rizal, "Do you remember our talks when we were alone in Ghent, in Belgium, when we used to talk about our dreams for the future of our mother country, of our dreams of revolution?" And from that seed, which Rizal and his like-minded compatriots had in their hearts and minds, people like Evangelista brought it back to the country, and they put ideas into reality. Because when you look at our most pivotal moments in our history, for me, I could pinpoint, if you want to pinpoint it. If you want to simplify it, of course, you're looking at the revolution, you're looking at the Japanese occupation, and you're looking at martial law. All of these three periods, the youth played such a pivotal role. In the revolution, of course, what Leloy said, they at first they were the thinkers, the starters. Later on, they were the generals. The Japanese occupation, same thing. A lot of our guerrilla leaders were on both ends, whether it's the Lavas and whether it's on the other side, they were young as well.
And Carlo, it came, a lot of it came from the ROTC cadets, you know?
That yes, the
these are the college people, no?
College people, yes. School, and even college, even the ones that were in a position of relative, we can call them middle management. Let's say, on both sides, whether they were Laurel or on the other side, naman the Commonwealth, you could like SP Lopez, Leon Maguerero. They were at that time in their 20s, and these were the officers. They were the ones running the Voice of Freedom, was it? The one that was being aired from Corregidor.
And then, of course, you also mentioned the Marcos period. And of course, when people talk about the Marcos period, we tend to only largely talk about Marxist youth leaders. But I also actually want to talk about the role of youth leaders who were inspired simultaneously by European social democracy, a kind of more moderate leftism that was in conversation with liberalism and Catholic social teaching. So ito yung mga taong nag-oorganisa. Well, marami sa kanila mga Atenista, but even some people outside Ateneo drank from this well. And I'm thinking of, you know, somebody like Commissioner Chito Gascon, of the Commission on Human Rights, Chair Chito Gascon, rather, of the Commission on Human Rights, who learned a lot of his human rights principles from his time as a youth activist in UP, and then brings that to the table now, and amidst these really important conversations
we're having. And Leloy, just so, again, to help the youth understand, no? And I think it's a very important point, because as early as then, when you were called an activist, red tagging na kaagad, di ba? Mm-hmm. Abas an activist ka, komunista ka, di ba? So,
Well, it's not true. You know, meron nga talaga mga komunistang aktivista, may mga Marxist activists. There are some activists who joined, like my parents actually joined the illegal Communist Party of the Philippines, but there were also some people who were more liberal or social democratic in orientation. A lot of these people, at least in the Ateneo, were influenced by Jesuit priests, for example, like Father Archie Intengan, right? And that's a very important history of youth activism that very few people have written about.
Mm-mm-mm. Yeah, very, very, and I think, Lelo, a very important stage, no? And something that we need to understand and bring forward also, as far as I'm concerned, because I was very much under Archie's mentorship also, no? So
Of course, Father Tito is a first-hand witness to this. So in a way, you were a youth activist also, Father Tito, of that.
Actually, I'll tell you, quotation marks, a funny story. I was actually invited to be one of the four founding student leaders of the League of Filipino Students.
Okay.
Which is Leon Alejandro at that time.
Wow.
I was fourth year college, but by that time my heart was moving towards teaching. So I was I declined, you know? Plus I guess I was still very young and could not nuance things that well, no? But immediately nag-red tagging ako. I sabi ko, extreme na kaliwa ito. So sabi ko, I politely declined, no? But I was supposed to represent Ateneo, no?
But one thing I want to point out, Father and Leloy, is even though we normally associate youth with a more fiery brand of nationalism, but there have been moments, points in our history where the youth decided to work within the system. And I, if I remember correctly, one of the better examples that I can think of is when Magsaysay ran for president, his campaign was spearheaded by the youth. I think it was this was Raul Manglapus when he was still relatively young. And I think they call it the People for Magsaysay movement or something along those lines. So you have these people and it worked. They through and I remember they brought such energy into his campaign. Of course, we know that Magsaysay was also the American candidate, but beyond that, Magsaysay's candidacy invigorated the electoral participation, and he was able to get the youth behind him. I remember they brought in new ideas, such as the very catchy Mambo Magsaysay jingle, which was written by Manglapus. And another example that I can think of was...
Which just an aside, Carlo, which was used a lot during 86.
Exactly. That's why I still remember it.
It's used a lot during 86. Yeah. It was played in Radio Bandido, Radio Veritas a lot. Yeah. Sorry. Go ahead.
So that's just one example of the youth working within the system to participate in civic action. And we also tend to forget our more prominent national leaders like Osmeña and Quezon. They rose to national prominence when they were in their 20s. Mm-hmm. So it's only now, I guess, that we've been so used to seeing old politicians on TV.
Yeah.
But it wasn't like that all the time for in our history.
Yeah, I think the kids today, they shouldn't think that the boomers will lord it over for much longer. They've really lorded it over the political the political conversation for such a long time. I remember there was a time when you opened the broadsheets, for example, and yung opinion section of the top broadsheets were like 90% boomer. They would have one token youth person there, right? Not even Gen X or boomer, right? So these were people born 46 until, you know, the early 60s. And I think that's cracking. I think now people are starting to realize that this great generation, of course, a big generation, it has had to cede its influence to a younger generation. And so it's a perfect opening within this discursive atmosphere of the Philippines for not just a new generation, but new generations to assert themselves in the national conversation.
And I just hope, no, it will be a generation that will be able to carry a more decent conversation, no? Rather than, I mean, I belong to the generation that messed it up, no? So I just hope that your generation and the younger ones would be able to carry a very decent dialogue, no? So
you know, change, Father Tito, can happen so fast in kasi within a span of generations. So I was listening to a Korean economist the other day, and he said that he was having a conversation between himself and his child. So he's probably in his 60s and his kid is maybe 20s. And so he tells his kid, "Do you know what Korean time is?" And his kid says, "I have no idea what Korean time is." Sabi niya, "During my time, Korean time meant an hour late." So exactly what we mean by Filipino time now.
Yes.
And yet, the span of one generation, nakalimutan na kung ano yung Korean time. So if something as deeply embedded as, you know, these time habits can change within a generation, who knows? You know, maybe this is the generation that will make us forget of Filipino time, you know?
I mean, it can happen. That's a good point. That's a very good point.
Especially also, Lele, because the way things are being done now, it's very tech savvy. So the youth has a leg up in the conversation. Unlike when I graduated from college, my first job was in government, in the Senate. And I was in my early 20s. There was a lot of us. There was a lot of us. I think every generation always has a willing willing youth who want to be part of government, who want to be part of the system. But in our case at that time, this was in the early 2000s. Slowly, one by one, we started dropping off because when we came in, we were essentially, our principals were the sons or daughters of the dynasties. So one, mentorship was gone, and second, we realized all our new ideas, all our innovations weren't being heard because we're essentially throwing it against older ears, because no matter how young our principals were, they still had to answer to their fathers. They still had to answer to their titos, and it was hard for us to bring in new ideas because it just wasn't being heard. Unlike now, I see that this may not exactly be the case because a lot of the battleground is in social media, and who knows that more than the youth.
Correct. Yeah. And as Lele mentioned, that the classroom is a very potent place, you know, to really nurture dreams and hopefully inspire them to act on their dreams. No, but that's the challenge now. No, for going on a second year, there's no classroom. No, going on our second year. So, how would that, in your thinking, how would that affect the dynamics of these particular elections? You know?
I think I might just reverse. I play around with the premise of the question a little bit, Father, kasi mahirap, honestly, mahirap sagutin.
Okay.
But one of the problems of online classes is you lack connection.
Correct. I agree with that. Yeah.
And I think there are multiple ways to introduce connection to your life. Well, one is to find, you know, make this pandemic end and allow people to see each other again. But I think the vote is a form of connection, actually. When you cast that vote, you're essentially saying, I'm connecting myself symbolically to a body politic. I'm saying I'm Filipino. I'm saying I'm accountable to this society. And I'm saying I am placing a bet on the future of this country. So that's a kind of connection. And if we think about it as a connection, then maybe it's mas magaan gawin yung proseso ng pagboto, lalo na now when everybody wants a little bit more connection.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I think also now more than ever, the role of parents is so important. Because what's happening now is I have a college, me and my wife have a college student and a grade 4 student. So since wala silang social interaction with anyone else other than us, in a sense, kami yung naging barkada nila ngayon eh. So kami yung laging kausap. And the parents, I mean, it's a fine line you have to take. You have to be a parent and you have to be a friend. But what I'm trying to say is we can influence our children greatly, especially at this moment. And I, just to tell my personal story, it was my son's first time to register. Nangyari lang to, father, maybe 2 weeks ago, he was finally able to register after the ECQ was lifted. And prior to that, you could tell it's hard. It's hard. You know how you deal with government bureaucracy, haba ang pila, you have to do all these requirements. But I took my inspiration from my father when I was, the first time I voted when I was 19 years old. And I could tell it was so important to my father. Voting. He never told me explicitly, get up, go and register. But I could tell every time I would see him, he would ask me, oh, have you registered? And I could tell that it was so important to him that ako mismo kumilos para mag-register. And if I never felt that sense of importance for my father, I personally, I think I knew it was important, but I wouldn't have had the urgency. Bata ako, may barkada na sa isip ko, gimmick na sa isip ko. Yeah, yeah. But seeing that from my father gave me that motivation. In the same way, I think my son saw the same thing in me because I would talk about politics, I would talk about what's happening, and they could tell it was very important to me. And actually, it was many attempts to do so. And na-impress ako kasi the first time he tried, hindi siya umabot sa cutoff. Dun sa one of those mobile registration. But he kept at it. He kept at it. And I think it's because I showed how important it was to me. And I think it's time to say, it's time as parents to tell our kids, this is important. This is important. Not just for, hindi na dapat abstract concept na sabihin natin, importante to para sa bayan. Hindi, importante to sa akin. Do it for me. Then he could see exactly what it will give him that motivation to vote. And that's what I did. I showed him, anak, importante sa akin to, gawin natin to. And it was relatively easy. By the way, we did it in Silang, Cavite, father, our nearby, and it took less than an hour.
I agree with you that the role of the parents is so important now, especially with all of these lockdowns and isolations. No? Kasi sila nga yung influence, di ba?
Tsaka sa akin yung importance nito is actually in a sense in the context of the Philippines, it's a matter of life and death. Bakit? Mm-mm. Kasi merong gobyerno na ang daming pinatay. Yeah. So it is incumbent upon us now to make sure to elect an administration that will make sure na managot yung mga pumatay kasi libo-libo ang pinatay and to ensure na hindi yun mangyayari ulit. Yeah. So this election is really a matter of life and death.
Yeah, yeah. Plus the corruption, Lelo, is really coming out. I mean, I think we will need, I'll invite you again a few weeks from now because I'd like to talk about the role of the youth during the pre-martial law, the martial law years, and then after. No, I think that's very important to discuss. So we'll have another episode on that. But as we wrap up this particular episode, what's your final appeal, maybe, to the youth? It's a few more days for registration. Of course, eventually we'll need to talk about how to vote or what to consider when they vote. No, not so much how to vote. No? Any final pitches, so to speak? No?
Well, I know it's the anniversary of martial law. According to Manolo Quezon, we should celebrate it on September 23. So September 23, yes, yes. Anniversary of martial law. And you know, the dictator collapsed because of a youth movement. And it's also not true statistically that it is the youth that want dictatorship to go back. So if you look at yung mga, for example, bumoto sa anak ng diktador for vice president noong 2016, these were mostly people in their 40s or in their 50s. In other words, people who were too young to remember the martial law years, but are too old to be idealistic. In other words, ito yung mga naging biktima talaga ng Marcos propaganda because batang-bata pa lang sila. Yeah. Ang una na nakita sa TV, Marcos propaganda. So if you look at that, meron talagang demographic problem na merong band of voters of a particular age na mas gustong autokrasya kaysa sa demokrasya. So it is now incumbent upon the youth to change the direction of Philippine history. And it's also incumbent upon the youth, given that this election is effectively going to be a referendum on mass murder, to repudiate the mass murder of the past 6 years.
Yeah. And corruption.
Yeah.
So, Carlo?
Sa akin, Father, I just want to point out again that the power of the youth, the youth's influence, it's been tried and tested in our history. So alam natin yan, whether it's in the revolution, martial law, and like I said earlier, in the more peaceful times, working within the system, like what they did with Magsaysay, they are very, very important in when it comes to civic action. But I think for me, what I'd rather get the message out to the parents. And this is the time for parents to talk to their kids, to their children, because we have a habit of not doing that. As a historian, alam mo to, di ba? Na naging problema nung post-war generation din nila pinag-usapan yung Japanese occupation. At the same time, yung martial law period, ang criticism, they don't talk about it enough, and so on and so forth. But it's time for us to talk to our kids, because I remember when I was voting, I was so heavily influenced by my parents, and I ended up voting for Raul Roco. Because at that point, to be honest, that's true. But I remember thinking that I was just taking my cue from my parents, because I didn't really know the issues that well, but yeah. Ang laki ng impluwensya ng magulang sa bata eh. Later on, of course, I developed my own understanding of Philippine politics, but more or less me and my dad and my mom always toe the same line. So parents, talk to your children.
Yeah. So again, thank you very much, and there's going to be a part 2 and 3 to this because I think it's always good to analyze the major issues, no? Like, because like, for example, Lele, what you said about the killings under this administration, I think we need to also talk about the killings during the martial law years.
Yes, no? Yeah.
Because these are lessons in history, for us Filipinos especially, no? that is being glossed over and talagang binabaon, di ba? Binabaon. Mm. So we'll talk about that. And of course, the issue of corruption, because I think in the end, we really need to, once and for all, take the bull by its horns. And people say, ang hirap ng corruption. I think we need to do something already. Yeah. So again, thank you very much. And hopefully, maybe a few weeks from now, not a month from now, we will begin to talk about certain important issues that need to be considered, no, in voting for the right candidate. So thank you, Leloy, as usual, and Carlo.
Glad to be here, Father.
Thank you very much, and hope to see you more often during the months leading to the elections. No? Thank you.